Wagoner, and just some statistics about local island stuff. I've lived on the island for 42 years. I've seen the massive amount of changes in that amount of time. I've been an architect in my own practice for 40 years, doing mostly public, larger public projects. I've done about 11 houses, I think, on Bainbridge over those 40 years. So I have a lot of familiarity with the island. I've been a member of the Bainbridge Photo Club for about 10 years, or maybe a little longer than that, starting about 2010. After joining about 2 years later, I was president of the club for 3 years. And then I kind of got burnt out, and passed the torch on to our next great president. The photo club has been great for me because I've been able to show my work, which I enjoy doing. I've been able to see other people's excellent work and learn from their experiences and what they've done to produce their images. And I like the camaraderie of the group as well. So it's a good organization. If you have 20 bucks, spend it on it, it's worth it. I wanted to say just a few things about my photography, just in general, the quote is, it was one that I ran across, and it was by a photographer named Elliot Erwitt, who's a French-born American documentary photographer, pretty well known, and I didn't know who he was, but I ran across this quote, and I was really struck by the two-sentence simplicity of it and how much information it packed. And I'm going to say the quote again.
Yes.
Photography is the art of observation. It has little to do with the things you see and everything to do with the way you see them. And I think a problem now in photography is that everybody's a photographer. If you have an iPhone, a point-and-shoot camera, you can be a photographer. And it's obviously degrees of photography that are a part of what it's about. And I think anybody that's a serious photographer really does, according to that sentence, basically, it's all about everything to do with the way you see. And that I think separates the day-to-day person taking pictures from the people that are good photographers. And I try to incorporate that two sentence idiom in my work, and it really is germane to what I do. I really don't capture pretty pictures or even people so much. And I don't do landscapes. I don't do beautiful mountain scenes. I try to look at things and try to give an alternate reality to them if I can. And that's the focus. And that is the part that I identify with. It's all about how you see things. And I try to see things not as they are, but as they could be, as they might be, as another way of looking at things. And that really is my focus of interest. I come from 40 years as an architect, and I think that gave me the benefit of being able to see things, alternate solutions to things, visualize other ways something could be looked at. I think that's lent a lot of education to my later photographic career. For me, photography is really, and I say this, and Norm, our president of the photo club, he and I joke about it, but I say that for me, what's important in photography is the why of a photograph. Why did you choose to click that image when you did? What was it you thought about before you snapped that picture? What were you trying to portray? What were you trying to express? Those are the things to me that are important before you take a picture. And I've read many quotes that say, what you think about before you take a picture is what's important, not so much taking the picture. So anyway, that's a way I look at photography. I spend time thinking about an image, a subject. I imagine in my mind how I could manipulate that subject, and then I capture it and try to create effects that are unusual or different, and a different way of seeing that subject. That's sort of what I'm interested in. For me, this is a little different than a lot of people. For me, a camera is just a step in the process. It's about a four-step process. One is thinking of what it is you want to capture, what it is you want to shoot, how you could manipulate that to to pass on the idea you're after, and then snapping the picture, and obviously then editing afterwards. And so like, a camera for me is just a tool in that continuing process. My focus, I said this already, but my focus is really the uniqueness of how I capture a subject and what I can create in an alternate illusion to reality from that subject. And anyways, you look at my pictures, that's something I think that shows through, is that I'm looking at alternate ways of seeing things and seeing an unreal situation in a real picture. So anyway, that's what I'm interested in. I take very few pictures. I'm really not very, very prolific. I figured out 14,000 pictures in 10 years. And that includes travel pictures. That includes the good, bad, and the ugly. What do I got on my screen here? What do I got? Recording. That includes travel pictures and the good, bad, and the ugly ones as well. So anyway, 14,000 pictures in 10 years is not a huge amount of pictures. And probably it's because when I take a picture, I spend a lot of time thinking about the picture before I take it. And whether there's a setup involved in it or just snapping something I'm interested in, I don't shoot very many pictures. One of my failings in photography is I don't take enough pictures. I don't know my camera very well. I'm really not technically oriented to a camera. It's just like a computer screen. It knows way more than I do. And my interest level in the technology is not huge. My interest level is more in the subject matter and what I'm shooting and how I can capture it and make something out of it. That's really what I'm mostly interested in. Let's see. I'm just going to pass on. This is the Reader Digest version, but this is the Reader's Digest version of how I became a photographer where I am. And I'm not going to go through since I was born, but I'll go through close to that. When I was in fifth grade, I got my first camera, and it was a camera that was about 2.5 inches by 2 inches, really a toy camera. It did have roll film in it that was about 1/2 inch wide. And I used that to take pictures, and my parents also bought me a plastic set of a photo lab equipment. So I was able to process those tiny little films. And I had the opportunity to use a school lab. And the only thing I remember is on a enlarger, making an enlargement of an airplane jet that was retired and sitting in an Air Force base. That's the only image I remember. From then on in high school, my parents had a Super 8 movie camera. Any of you that are old folks like me probably know the wind-up Super 8 movie cameras. And I, in high school, I took that and I taped on the front of it a square, a brass tube that was polished on the inside. And I went around and took these sort of kaleidoscope pictures of shooting through this glass tube or through this brass tube. And then in college, I had a number of photographic experiences. One is I was hired by a local women's clothing store to photograph co-eds on campus in their fashions. And that was quite a good experience, actually. The other things is I did have some photos published in the weekly daily newsletter for the University of Washington. And that was another experience. But probably my big claim to fame in college photography was in the architecture department. They had a full photo lab there. And I got into producing fake driver's licenses from California for my friends so they could get into bars and taverns. California driver's licenses at that time were basically a photograph with your picture and ice. So I used one and then re-put different picture and changed the ages and stuff on it. And that was my big claim to fame. And in retrospect, I think that was probably a felony, but I'm not positive about that.
True confessions today.
I think it's past the time frame when I could be thrown in jail. Then I had a 40-year career as an architect and mostly took pictures of travel and buildings. That's really what I focused on. And retired in 2010. And bought way more photographic equipment than I ever could either explain or justify. And I bought the triad of the holy grail of Nikon lenses, and I bought them used from B&H Photo in New York. and a bunch of other lenses. So I was well stocked with equipment and just started shooting pictures in 2010 in retirement as my one of my main activities. About 5 years ago, I came to the realization that I really wasn't interested in competitions and pursuing judge sorts of photography. I really thought about not being that interested in what other people thought of my work. I really focused on the thought that what's important to me is what I think of my work. And if other people like it, fine. If they don't, if they laugh at it, so be it. So I really just zeroed in on what I wanted to do and how I wanted to achieve it. And if other people liked it, that was great. And I continue with that thought to this day. Let's see. I really was really about pleasing myself. And I think in photography, that's probably for everybody is the most important pursuit of their photography. So that's the This Is Your Life scenario, Reader's Digest version. And I don't know if you know This Is Your Life. Some of you old folks like me probably remember it. It was ran from 1951 to 61 as a major show on TV. And I think it was Joey Bishop that did it, not positive. But anyway, so that's the This Is Your Life. Now what we're doing is to jump into images. And as you look at my images, think about the issue of the two sentences that I had mentioned. About it's not what you see, but how you see it that's important. And I try to use that in all of my images. How do you see something rather than what do you see? And so anyway, we'll get started here if we can.
Come on, there we go. So is this, you want me to just jump ahead from this?
Okay. Yeah, well, the only thing about this is just what I put together for this little show, and it's basically a peeling paint at a junkyard in a Belfair, and I just was enamored with the colors in it and the textures in it. So anyway, yeah, that now you can go on.
Oh my gosh, now is this the Palouse?
What's on my screen is still the one last, there we go. In 2011, this was a shot I took in the Palouse. And it was at dusk and the sun was coming over the far hillside. That's why it looks so red. And the foreground was actually in shadow. And I just happened to stumble on this image and or this site. And I, as a neophyte, I actually entered this in a international competition for Photographers Forum magazine that had 12,000 entries. And this came in one of the top 100. And this sort of propelled me, well, maybe I should try to do something with photography. So anyway, it was early on and it was put in a book by Photographers Forum and it has been well received over the years. So anyway, that was sort of a beginning photo. But still pretty realistic, but had a little sort of quality of abstraction to it, but not much.
A little surrealism, yes.
What's that?
A little serialism, it seems like.
Yes.
Yes.
And the undulating curving form in photography is a real great subject matter. So.
Want me to go next?
Yes, please.
Okay. There we go.
I'll just say next, okay?
Okay, perfect.
Okay, this was at the, in 2011 in the same trip to the Palouse. And this was a barn I stumbled on, and what intrigued me about this barn was the paradox of the brand new looking truck parked in this dilapidated falling down structure, and I called it the Palouse parking garage. And one thing in photography that I learned early on is it's kind of a no-no, it's been overused, of having a black and white photograph with a little tiny bit of color in it. And I knew that, but I was still so enamored with the dichotomy of the two that I left in the red brightness of the truck and made black and white and desaturated the rest of the image. And this photograph, like many photographs that we all take, are photographs of things that no longer exist. This actually fell down a few years later after this image was taken. So it's no longer there to capture the photograph. So there's certainly history to photography that is a good thing. Yes, go ahead. Okay, this is my first early venture of taking a picture of another artist's work and doing it in a different manner than the original artist. And some people say that's copying or cheating. And I think as long as you use the work of someone else in a way that is different than they intended, and you capture it differently, maybe you crop it differently, it becomes valid. So in my mind, this was a valid photograph. This happens to be a Chihuly installation at Seattle Center. And the installation really is turned upside down. These look like plumber's friends marching along the floor. And I decided to turn them upside down and make them look more like flowers and edit it with extending some of the stems, deleting a few stems, and changing the coloration a bit. And that was a first effort at modifying another person's artwork. So that's about all I can say about it.
Hey, has Chihuly seen this?
No.
Okay. Okay. No. We'll keep a secret.
All right. Well, here's where I really started getting into abstract photography. And I and David Warren, who's a club member who has been very active this past year, took about three trips over to the Belfair Auto Wrecking Yard. And it was really a bonanza of possible abstract photographs. And I took many photographs, and it was basically of using car parts and the deterioration of them in ways in photos that created abstractions. And this is just one of many, many photographs I've taken. And this I always thought of as a tulip. And I love the texture quality of it when I took it. And I love the combination of the colors of the blue and the red and the yellow together. I always was wondering whether the lower left-hand red area should have been downplayed or taken off to really reinforce the tulip vertical quality of it, but I never went that far with it. This series of images I put into a slideshow and that won actually first place at the Northwest Council of Camera Club conference. And it was put to music by the Rolling Stones of my brand new car, I think it was called. Obviously not brand new cars, but anyway, so I really started getting into looking at things differently when I made these trips to the junkyard and went from there. I actually, the photo club in Silverdale, which I went to for some period of time, at Christmas time, they were showing slideshows and everybody was showing these great trips they'd taken and where they'd been and all these fabulous places around the world they were going. And I got up and I said, you know, I didn't have the money to go anyplace fancy, so I just went to the junkyard. And so then I showed this slideshow. Anyway, go ahead.
Just goes to show you can find beauty everywhere.
Yes.
Now look.
Okay. I had just bought, at this period of time, it was 2015, I guess, bought a new Nikon point and shoot. And it was sort of the top end Nikon point and shoot at that time. And I went into Seattle just to try it out and shoot different images. And I saw on the sidewalk in, on Pike Street in front of the Hard Rock Cafe, this reflection in a puddle in the sidewalk. And I was really struck not by just the Hard Rock reflection, but by the billboard that was on the building next to it with this guy. And I can't even remember what he was advertising, but the juxtaposition of him and the guitar struck me as interesting. And just as I was about ready to take the picture, it started raining. And actually, as far as I'm concerned, that was perfect because it created the raindrops, particularly at the lower left-hand corner, and it reinforced the fact that it was a puddle as opposed to reality in a building. And I thought that was really a helpful hint in the terms of what the image was. And this image did win me a few local awards for originality. So back then. So anyway, go ahead.
Interesting. Oh, She's greater.
This is an all white picture I took during a heavy snowstorm. Okay. All right. Well, I've gone through in my life a couple of these periods where I just got totally zeroed in on a subject matter, and one that I basically composed, which I've done a lot of my photography is composing things and then setting them up and then figuring out how to shoot them. And I took many, many pictures like this. This was from my kitchen. This was my cheese grater, which was a flat cheese grater. And it had a lot of scarring on it from various use. And I decided to, because it was very reflective, even though it had these scratches all over it. And I decided to try to shoot a reflection against it. And this was holding a beach blanket up in front of the cheese grater. And I took a number of pictures like that. And then I started thinking, well, the holes in the cheese grater, I should do something with those. I mean, a lot of the ones I took were just black behind the cheese grater. And then I started crumbling tissue paper and putting it behind the cheese grater to get some imagery through the holes. And this was one of many that I had done. And this was actually one of my favorites because I liked the color combination of what was achieved, and the scratches I thought added a lot of textural quality to the image. So anyway, one of many. I think I went through a cheese grater phase twice in the last 10 years. So
you are so creative. This is amazing.
Anyway, well, I have fun. And I think a lot of it is just having an architectural background. I just sort of look at things and I can see different ways of using them. And I think that the design background probably helps a lot me in my photography.
Right. Yeah.
Go ahead.
On to the next.
Okay. This image was taken at the Air and Space Museum in Seattle. And it was one that really struck me that I could really do something with this immediately when I saw it. And the image was these model rockets. The Space Museum had put them on the inside in a window display. So you look through the window, you see the sky beyond, and the rockets were inside. And I thought, you know, it would be really interesting to make those rockets look like they were outside. So in this image, I wanted also to capture something outside that had a reality to it, to give some scale to the thing and just some realness to the environment. And so that's why the telephone pole in the lower corner. So to do this image, it was actually quite simple. All I did was clone the horizontal mullion that goes at a diagonal across the thing, clone it across a couple of the rockets. And the same with the one in the upper left-hand corner, cloning that mullion across the part of the rocket. So it easily made the image look like rockets outside rather than inside. And so that was the idea of this photograph. The other odd little thing, and I it's something I just did as a peculiarity, and I don't know why I even did it, but I like it, was adding, I desaturated everything except this little orange and these flag banner that ran from telephone pole to telephone pole. And I decided to leave that color in, and it doesn't have much impact, but I, for some reason, it struck me as something I wanted to keep in it. So anyway, that's that image. This is I think a lot of people were intrigued by how did that come about. So very simply, just moving a few mullions around.
I love the title too, 3-2-1 okay. Blast off. Perfect.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Whose arms are these?
Okay. You know, as I showing these pictures, just a comment about them, these are not what I consider my best pictures. They're to me what I consider the breadth of interest I have. And so as you see these, you know, I've taken lots of different pictures of different subject matter, and these just were trying to explain the subjects of interest to me, to you. And this happens to be two fairly heavy women at the Gay Pride, prior to the, in the morning before the Gay Pride parade. And I saw these two women with these major tattoos on their arms, and one was in a white shirt and one was in a navy shirt. And it's one of the few times in my life that I had the initiative to go up to them and ask them if they would stand back to back and let me take a shot of their tattoos, and which they very willingly did. And I don't know, I've always liked it because it is a subject matter that very few people would take on. And I probably went to the gay pride, have gone to the gay pride parade 3 different times photographing it. And it's really one of the most wonderful photographic experiences I've had, because the people there are very reassuring about you taking their pictures. They like to be photographed. They enjoy posing. They enjoy sort of flaunting what they look like. And it's been a great experience. Again, I've made a slideshow of portraits from gay pride parades that I have. But anyway, it's a subject matter that I really enjoy, and I really enjoy the people who are very willing to be photographed. And we didn't have it last year because of COVID, and didn't have it this year because of COVID. So I'll be back there next year taking more of these sorts of things. But
I hope so.
It's very photogenic to go there and find imagery to take pictures of.
Fantastic.
Okay, this is now back to, again, I'm not sure whether you guys all think this is legitimate or not, but this is taking a cropped photo of somebody else's artwork. And this happens to be Claus Oldenburg's tulip up on Fifth Avenue at a bank. And I turned it 90 degrees. But I took it and darkened out the background and created just sort of an abstraction of colors out of the photograph, and cropped it in a different manner. I had some other friend photographers of the photo club that went and did the same thing, and they couldn't quite come up with the imagery that this projected. And you know, a thing about abstract photography too is that one thing they always say about abstract photography, if you're doing an abstract photograph, you should be able to turn it any direction, 90 degrees this way, upside down, back and forth, backwards, horizontally, and it still should come across as some abstraction. You aren't held by the rules of photography, and I've really taken that to heart. I'm totally comfortable with turning things upside down or backwards or whatever. I've even tried to incorporate white border into the photograph by having white sections of the border come into the photograph. Anyway, just different ways of looking at things. And this one has just turned 90 degrees. And I never crossed my mind that it's a problem. So that's just one part of doing abstract photography, I think, is the ease of that. Go ahead. Okay, so the yet another image of taking pictures of somebody else's artwork is, you probably all pretty much are aware or familiar with this major tree that's in the lobby of the Sam Art Museum downtown. And I don't know, it must be 80 feet long, and it's made out of these tiny little 1/2 inch by 2 inch blocks of wood. And I got into trying to do abstractions of small portions by shooting just sort of cropped parts of it. And this is one that I made as a composition. And for me, the things that I was appealing to me, and then I obviously turned it into a black and white image, but what was appealing to me was the undulating nature of it and the value change from black to white. And it, to me, it has sort of a bit of an imagery of an Albrecht Dürer etching, and in a contemporary sort of way. And I did also put it in a very high contrast black and white mode as I edited it. So I have, again, have a number of these compositions of chunks of the tree. Very neat tree if you haven't seen it. Very cool. So, yes.
Definitely have to go check that out.
Yeah.
Oh, Slinky.
Okay. My Slinky phase. My Slinky phase took 2 times in the 10 years, and I still am enamored with Slinkies. I can still focus on them again. I mean, I love the undulating quality of them. I love the repetition of the form and the sort of, I don't know, it's almost ballet-like sense of what you can do with them and their movement and motion. And so I got really into taking pictures of Slinky. I bought a couple of Slinkies, and when I first started, I was taking pictures of a slinky and either just hanging it or laying it on something and shooting it either close up or from different angles. So I got lots of slinky pictures. And then I started thinking, well, I could take a slinky and hang it and put a mirror under it and then shoot that. And I would get two images of the slinky. You'd have to, when you do that, you have to put a mirror under the, would be the right side of the slinky on the left. And then above that slinky on the left, you have to put a black covering because the mirror is reflecting what's above the slinky on the left. Mm-hmm. And so you have to have a dark covering above you rather than below you and the mirror being below you. So this is actually a mirrored slinky turned 90 degrees to actually make it look like they're two dancing slinkies together. So this is when I sort of got further along in my slinky interest and started experimenting with the mirrored slinkies. So.
Fascinating.
Go ahead.
Okay. Oh, this place looks familiar.
Yeah, everybody knows this place. And I won't spend too much time on this, but when I turned 65, I had the opportunity to think about the goals for the rest of my life, which is something I don't know if people do, but I did. And most of them were family and friend related goals. And one goal I had was that I wanted my photography to be exhibited in a gallery or a museum at some point before I died. That was a goal I set for myself. And fortunately, I've now had it exhibited in four galleries and one museum, this being the museum, and one of them as far away as Florida. And so I've achieved that. And I think I've had my 15 minutes of fame, so which I'm happy with and fine with. I'd like to just, maybe this will be boring for everybody, but the story behind this is when I got to do this, I had never shown in a gallery or a museum before. And I decided I was going to call the curator, Greg Robinson, and ask him if I could come in and talk to him about putting some photos in the cafe. They usually have like four images that are less important than the ones in the main museum. And I thought I could maybe get him to put some of my photos in there. So I made an appointment and to talk to him and the assistant curator, Amy Sawyer. And I was absolutely totally nervous because as an architect, I've done lots of presentations for architectural projects over the years, but I'd never spoken to a curator of a museum or knew how to approach a curator of a museum. But anyway, I went in and sat down with them and I took a whole bunch of images, you know, matted and some unmatted. And then I had made a book for myself of these images from the Ferris wheel in Seattle and sat down with the curator and his assistant, and they just looked at the book. They didn't even look at my images. And they said, well, we don't want you to do something in the cafe. We'd like you to be a part of an abstract show 9 months from now in the summer of 2019. We'd like you to have images in that show. And they said, we can give you a 12-foot wall that you could probably get three presented images on. And I was just stunned. I went in there to get a couple of images of the coffee shop, and it was an abstract called Departure and Arrival, which I thought was very fitting for abstract work. You know, you start out with what is the subject and you arrive somewhere else with it. So anyway, it was called Departure and Arrival. And I decided I was going to try to do something different than just three photographs behind glass and in frames. I thought I really wanted to step up the presentation in a museum to something different than that. And so I came up with an idea to do these 3 6-foot long fabric panels with photographic images on them and to hang side by side in kind of a triptych form. And on the three panels, I could put 9 images. So instead of getting 3 framed pictures, I decided I would be getting 9 images on 3 panels. So anyway, the idea appealed to me, and this fabric panels. And I called Greg and I said, I have this idea what I want to do. And he said, we don't really like things we haven't seen. And, you know, which I understand, they don't want you to bring something sight unseen. So anyway, I decided to make a mock-up, a half-scale mock-up of one of the panels. And so I had a company in Seattle, Alpha Graphics, work with me to make one fabric panel. I had a real clear idea of what I wanted for fabric, and had them made a half scale model. And I took it into Greg and showed it to him, and he said, great, do it. And so he was totally happy with the idea. And while we were sitting there, he said, by the way, we'd like you to do something in the front window. And I thought, you're kidding. I mean, all I want to do is get something in the cafe. Mm-hmm. And now he wants me to do something in the front window. They gave me $2,500 to produce something in the front window. And I spent hours and hours working on this because it was such a plum to work on. The front window of the museum has lots of problems with it. The mullioning, and as you can see, some of them are at an angle. The spacing of mullions doesn't really work for a layout of something inside. I mean, as an architect, I'm seeing these things. And it has to be seen from the outside during the day and night. Mm-hmm. And it has to be seen from the inside during the day, particularly. So it's something, it had to be a two-sided thing. And it had to be something that I could use photographs without them getting so big that they were pixelated and that they were still reasonably sharp. And so there were a lot of parameters to how to do this. So you can go to the next slide.
Okay.
So to produce this, what I did was I took a picture of the outside of the window of the museum, and I had Sound Graphics make a to scale picture, like 1/4 inch per foot scale. And then I made these whole bunch more, way more than this, little cutouts that were all 1/4 inch, the same scale as the front window. And I just kept moving them around to different compositions with the background being the window of the museum, and move them around. And then I would take a picture of each composition and then move them around some more. And I started out with just random compositions, and I ended up with what I thought was a very simple composition, which is basically the left and the right are the same form, just inverted. And so it was a very simple composition, and, you know, very regular. And a couple of the other parameters in producing this was, one, the major scene images are at the first floor and second floor. So there's actually the second floor, there's 2, 4, 6 images that are above the railing line of the second floor. And in the first floor, there's 5 images below the ceiling of the first floor. And the 4 in the middle are kind of spanning between the 2 floors. So they're less seen. So I wanted to do something from the outside that connected the 2 floors. And I wanted to do something from the inside that had the punch at the 2 floors. So I also came up with, I had an idea of what I wanted to do this on. I had an idea for a fabric that was translucent, very tight weave, a little bit of sheen to it. And I thought, I'm never going to find this fabric. I went to Alpha Graphics in Seattle, and they had 3 fabrics that would have worked that were translucent, various degrees of translucency. And so I picked one and had a dry, these were, each panel is 3 feet by 3 feet. And did a dry run with them of one panel to see if they were going to be pixelated at 3 feet by 3 feet, or if they were sharp enough. And so we made one panel, and because it's fabric, it seemed to be okay. So anyway, I went ahead and came up with the final layout. And in this, I thought, well, I'm going to do it such that this is sort of day and night, or night and day, depending on which way you want to go. With the left panels being representing night, and the right panels representing day. And they also wanted at the corners, the corner panels to kind of interact with one another. So if you see the upper left-hand corner, those are sort of radiating similar panels, but they're kind of tied together. And the colors in the upper right-hand one sort of tie together, and same with the lower right and left. So I mean, there's a lot of thought process that went into how I formulated doing this. And then, and this was specifically designed for that window, I mean, as far as the size and the height and everything. And I ended up having these panels made with a loop at the bottom and top, of which I then, in my shop, I fabricated some aluminum rod top and bottom of each panel that then hung off wires that the museum put in. And so that was the whole thing there. And you know, it's, as I said, my 15 minutes of fame, but I'm proud of what I did. And Greg and the crew there really liked it. And it was done over the summer when they didn't have fireworks on Bainbridge, and they thought it was perfect for a non-fireworks year on Bainbridge.
So, right.
Anyway, next one.
Okay.
Okay, this, go ahead, what?
Up close.
Yes, this is an image in the many I did. When I first thought about doing some pictures of the Ferris wheel, I thought the only one I really thought about was a full shot from the ferry dock, because it's the only place you could get a full image of the wheel. And so I took an 80 to 200 millimeter lens in, and took several shots, not this one, but took several shots. And then I thought, well, I'm going to walk on up to the thing and take some pictures. And I realized that at 80 to 200, I was too close to get the full wheel in. So I had to start thinking of what images could I take without the full wheel. And so I did a whole lot. And I had so much fun, I went in two more nights and took pictures with different lenses. So this was all over three January nights taking these images. This one happens to be a picture of shot of the Ferris wheel while it was spinning. And it was shot with a 28 to 300 millimeter lens, starting out at 28 and then zooming over 6 seconds to 300 millimeters. So that's why you see the Ferris wheel lightly in the background, and this thing in the upper left-hand corner is at 300 millimeters as it pulled it forward. And so you see, as the Ferris wheel is spinning, the lights on the Ferris wheel are changing color from blues and orange to sort of purplish colors. And then the horizon line is kind of in the bottom third of the image. So anyway, this is one of my favorites, even though it was quite bizarre and a little more colorful than I would normally do in my photography, but I really like the image and how it turned out. This image was in a gallery show in Florida. I can't even remember the town, but someplace in Florida, and back a year ago. So anyway, great time taking pictures of the Ferris wheel in different ways.
Wow.
Yeah, none of them look like a Ferris wheel. They're all bizarre images. So, okay, go ahead. Okay, subsequent to the Ferris wheel venture, I was invited to Bainbridge Arts and Crafts to be a part of a 17-person photography exhibit. And I, again, wanted to do something a little out of the norm from your normal glass and framed photograph. And so I had these images, and these are one of the several of the few images I've made that are really as simple as they could be as far as an image. And I have to say, these sorts of images are really hard to find and do, because it's hard to take things and boil them down to such simple shapes. So these were about shape, and that was it. Anything related to tonal changes from black to white were gotten rid of. So anyway, I made these three panels that were on matte aluminum. I mean, aluminum is sort of thought about as not a photographer's medium, really, a real photographer's medium. But I wanted these things to be crisp, and I wanted them to have a slight sheen flat to the panel. And these are matte aluminum. I worked with a company in Vancouver, Washington to make these three panels. And then as an architect, I wanted to treat them rather than glass and frames, treat them so there was a little sense of my architectural background. So that's where you see the aluminum channels top and bottom, partially framing the images. Now I have to say, when these were part of the 17 photographer show, they were so far out from anything else in the show that I don't know if I was a little embarrassed or I was happy. But they definitely were nothing like anybody else's photography in the show. So, and I think people that came in and looked at it weren't even sure they were photographs. But anyway, I like trying to find these kind of images simple. The image on the left is actually a corner of a poster, lower right-hand corner of a poster. The image in the middle is of a car hood, race car hood, and the two black objects on the upper left are the windows into the driver sits. And the one on the right is at the Air and Space Museum. It's part of a logo on the side of a plane for some company. So, but anyway, I probably have a very small collection of this kind of a photography, but I like boiling things down to the sort of simple black and white graphics, and that's what these really represent.
Fascinating. Oh my gosh.
Anyway, go ahead.
Okay.
Okay. Next topic. This was a couple of years ago, and the viaduct in Seattle was on its way down. Actually, as an architect, I had been talking and hearing about it coming down for 30 years, and it never happened. So when it did happen, I thought, you know, this is a subject worth recording as a historical thing for Seattle, you know, the removal of it, because it's been such a topic for so long, and now it's finally going away to improve the waterfront. And so I spent, the demolition took 10 months, and I spent 10 months off and on going over and photographing the demolition. And I decided I didn't want to just photograph it, and photographs would be pretty boring because you get all the background noise from the building facades and the things going on around it. I wanted to really minimize that and focus on sort of the graphic idea of the teardown. And this is just one of a whole slideshow I made of the teardown of the viaduct. And in this, I highlighted all of the background buildings and basically overexposed them to the point that there's just some little line quality to them to minimize their impact. And then I added to on, and I did this on all the images so they had a sort of a context that was similar throughout the slideshow. I added this sort of rusty orange tone to all of the images because it seemed fitting for something being torn down and going back to nature. So anyway, this was just one of, I don't know, dozens of pictures I took. And as I said, I did a slideshow of the teardown, which actually, I think it came in third place in Northwest Council of Camera Club's slideshow competition. But anyway, it's a phase. I just thought it was something worthy to record, and I wanted to record it in a way different than would be the norm. So that's what that's all about.
A little bit of history here. Yep.
Yes, a bit of, oddly done history. Okay, people in the photo club probably remember this, because this isn't that long ago. This was an image of a big block of styrofoam. I think it's probably, it's about 7 feet high by 4 feet wide by 4 feet wide. It was standing vertically on a beach in Lake Shores. And I think other photographers are too, but I'm particularly enamored with the deterioration of man-made things. And, you know, I see nature as reclaiming rightfully what man has made and tearing it down and recycling it into the environment. And when I saw this all rusty, it's actually styrofoam covered with a metal screen. I saw this, I thought about that it was in the process of being, I don't know, styrofoam takes a long time to get rid of, but the metal certainly was deteriorating. And I like that this is a subject matter because of the texture of the metal, the color combination of the rusty color and the yellow and the blue. It was a nice combination of colors. And so I just composed a chunk, a small part of the big block into a composition. And it's a kind of a loose looking thing. And anyway, that's something I've enjoyed doing, is taking pictures of rust and deteriorating things. So go ahead. Okay, this image was done, I think, was it last summer when the Black Lives Matter riots happened in Seattle?
Yes.
Right after the riots, I went into Seattle to see what I could shoot. And this happened to be in Pioneer Square. And I just saw a degree of symbolism in this image, and the symbolism being the background behind the door, broken door, glass broken door. Behind it was an image of the different ethnicities, from white to red to black to brown, and then this sort of broken imagery across the front of them in the door. And I basically took this because I did sort of get into that symbolism that this image created. And I have, particularly in the last 4 years, I've done a lot of symbolic images, which I don't tend to show to anybody because politics are different between people, but I've done a lot of images of the flag, the U.S. flag, in various states of deterioration or manipulated, and that's in the because of the politics in the last 4 years. And so anyway, I have a whole collection of those, but I don't tend to show them to anybody other than myself because of the political viewpoints from different people. So, mm-hmm. But I do enjoy having symbolism in a photograph, and it makes a statement about what's happening in the world right now.
Exactly. Okay.
Okay, this is a more recent interest. I often in the morning, usually about an hour, sit and read a book on my couch, lie and read a book on my couch. And I have this light that has six LED lights in a row on it. And I was reading my book, and I held my hand up to turn a page, and these six lights created from my hand six different shadows and overlapping one another. And I thought, well, that's pretty interesting. I could do something with that. So first I started by taking pictures of my hand and having these six shadows cast in different forms. And then I started going further afield and started taking shadows of objects. And then sort of the next phase for me was taking shadows of the shadows and foregoing the object. So this happens to be a picture of the shadows created by six LED lights of a spiny seashell. And it creates these sort of different levels of darkness of shadows depending on how far the light is from the object. And then I treated it in, I think it was, Lightroom for sure. I'm not sure what other program I used. I really wanted to make it sort of a watercolor-esque image. So that's where this came about. And I've done lots more with these shadow images. I think I've got a couple more in here to show you, but this is more recent work. And again, it's far afield from sort of your normal photography. Okay. Okay, this is one that's just last year that I did. And it's kind of almost impossible to see what the reality of the photograph was, but this was a half dome, a half ball, I guess a half ball of radiating wires that wired from the center point, poked out and created the shape of a ball. And I don't know, partway down, you can see the tips of some of the wires. But this again was shot through the wire globe and using six LED lights situated on the bottom of the screen or toward the bottom of the screen, shooting through the wires, and it created these multitude shadow patterns. And then I actually edited in, I think it was Topaz, quite a bit to change the imagery of the shadow pattern and adds the color around it and so forth. So again, I was still experimenting with these six LED lights and shadow forms. This actually had the form in it and the shadows beyond. Go ahead. Okay, this is yet another shot picture of the same object. You know, it's interesting. You can take a form, and there's just a multitude of ways you can look at it, try different things with it. And that's what I was doing with these six LED lights. I was just looking at all kinds of ways you could use them and have fun with it. This again was the half globe, which you can see more clearly of the projecting wires. And in this one, I actually placed the lights to the top of the screen and shined the lights with the various shadows down through the globe to create the shadow patterns on the bottom, and then and edited it in Lightroom and Topaz to create the different colors and so forth.
Beautiful.
So that's that. Now we're heading near the end here. I use this image a lot because I think it's sort of, I wouldn't say quaint, but it's cute. So I wanted to just leave you guys, and then I'll listen to if there are any questions. I probably aren't, but if there are any questions, but I just want to leave you with a couple of thoughts. And one is to back up to where we started and to quote this quote again. And this is, I think, for photographers. This is This is what we all should try to think in our mind as we take pictures. Photography has little to do with the things you see and everything to do with the way you see them. I think as far as photographers go, we should try to always think about why I'm taking a picture. What is the impression that I want to capture? How do I look at the subject differently than everybody else? As I said, everybody has a camera anymore. Everybody's a photographer. How can you stand out by looking at a common subject differently than your neighbor? Focus on how best to capture the idea you're after before you're clicking the shutter. Be open to alteration and changes in your initial idea as you edit the picture. I mean, I do that all the time. I have a simple idea that I want to project, and as I start manipulating it, I come up with different ways of looking at it. You are your own critique. Please yourself, take chances and experiment. The options in photography are endless. So that's my spiel for the